Exodus chapter 32, and we'll start reading at verse number 1. If you'd stand with me and just stretch for a minute, stand with me. We're going to read a few verses, and I'm going to just read down. And if you have to title the sermon tonight, it's just going to be Far From God, Far From God. Exodus chapter 32 and verse number 1. I'll read it aloud as you read along quietly, and we read down to verse number 8. The Bible says, "And when the people saw that Moses delayed to come down out of the mount, the people gathered themselves together unto Aaron and said unto him, Make us gods which shall go before us, for as for this Moses, the man that brought us up out of the land of Egypt, we wot not what has become of him. And Aaron said unto them, Break off the golden earrings which are in the ears of your wives and of your sons and of your daughters, and bring them unto me. And all the people brake off the golden earrings which were in their ears, and brought them unto Aaron, and Aaron received them at their hand, and fashioned it with a graving tool after he had made it a molten calf, and he said, These be thy gods, O Israel, which brought thee up out of the land of Egypt. And when Aaron saw it, he built an altar before it, and Aaron made proclamation, and said, Tomorrow is a feast to the Lord. And they rose up early on the morrow, and offered burnt offerings, and brought peace offerings, and the people sat down to eat and drink, and rose up to play. And the Lord said unto Moses, Go get thee down for thy people, which thou broughtest out of the land of Egypt, have corrupted themselves. They have turned aside quickly out of the way which I commanded them. They have made them a molten calf, and have worshipped it, and sacrificed thereunto, and said, These be thy gods, O Israel, which have brought thee up out of the land of Egypt. And let's pray, and then you may be seated. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the opportunity to be in church tonight. I thank you for your word and what it can teach us in our lives. Help us to be more like you. Holy Spirit, I pray that you use me. I'm not adequate to be standing in a pulpit or address anybody, but I pray that you speak through me, speak to hearts now. Help us to be more like you. I pray that everybody here would be spirit-filled listeners, for that they would apply what you have to their lives. Lord, help us to be better Christians and to serve you better. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. Here in this portion of Scripture, we don't really have to go back for a whole lot of background. You have a story of Moses, and of course, God's people were in Egypt for a period of time, and the Bible tells us that God heard their cry, and that God decided to take them out of the land of Egypt. And he rose up a man named Moses, and Moses went back and forth between Pharaoh and different things, and Pharaoh was challenging God, and every turn, God was using Moses to bring God's people out of Israel. And so finally, Pharaoh did let Israel go, and then they go to the Red Sea, and God delivers them at the Red Sea when the Egyptians start coming to them. And then God brings them through the wilderness, through many things, and he provides for them. And you see that God gives them food, and God gives them water, and they complain, and they just develop a system of complaining and just being despondent towards the things of God, being unappreciative of what God has done for them. And then they get to this mount, and Moses goes up to God, and God says, I'm going to give you a law that you're going to live by. And Moses says, goes up to the top of the mount, and he's there communing with God, and God starts giving him a law that the people are supposed to live by. Why? Because they've been in Israel, they've been in Egypt for 400 years. They need to learn again how to live the way that God wanted them to live. So God gave him a preacher. That preacher was going to take the word of God and say, now this is the word of God, and this is what we're going to live by. And no matter what, this is what we're going to live by. And so God brought them out by Moses. Moses is up getting the tablets, and about halfway down you have Joshua. And then at the bottom of all this, you have a man named Aaron that's supposed to be working with the people of Israel, showing the taste, being in Moses' stead, and telling everybody, now this is the way we're supposed to live. And then we pick up in verse number 1, and we see that the people, they said, we want not as be what has become of Moses. They said, we don't know what's going on with him, or we don't know what has become of him. They said he could have died, he could have gone crazy, we don't know what's going on with Moses, he's just at the top of the mountain, and we haven't seen him in a long time. So we see here that Moses, the man of God, he's up with God, communing with God, getting God's law for God's people. We see there's somebody between Moses and the people, and that's Joshua. And then we'll see that later on. And then we see Aaron, who's supposed to be keeping the way things are going. But you see that the people down at the bottom, they're far from God. They're far from God. And if we look at their lives and the way that things go on, the way that they do, we'll see that there's some steps that they had taken in their lives that often happen. You can see it in America. I'm going to point out several things that you see it in America. You see it in America's homes. You see it in America's churches. And then you see it in personal lives. And if we could track these things, I think if we were to identify them in our lives, and we could realize, first of all, when we're getting away from God, when we're getting away from God. Because the Christian life is not about everybody else. The Christian life is about you. It's about me. It's about me taking introspection and learning what I'm supposed to be as a Christian. So we start learning this. We start learning the story. And I'm just going to jump right into it and right into the sermon. And the first way that you could tell that you're getting away from God is the first way is you get away from the man of God. Get away from the man of God. I know Pastor Haley, he's been a good friend of mine, and he's not pastor here long, but he's in Revelation, God calls the pastor the angel. He's a messenger. Yeah, and Ecclesiastes, we learned this morning, we were looking at it, and it's God. Solomon called himself the preacher. We learned that in the Bible, that the pastor is there to give us warnings, as in all the prophets did of the Old Testament. We learned that he's there to give us wisdom, like we learn in Ecclesiastes. The preacher gives us wisdom. And then we learn that he's to lead us in worship. He sets a pattern in our church and in our Christian lives. And he tells us about how God wants us to live. But you see, when people start distancing themselves away from the man of God, when they say, I don't want to be around him anymore, then you see they start getting away from God. The Bible says that they said, when they went to Aaron, they said, up, make for us gods, which shall go before us. For as for this Moses, the man that brought us up out of the land of Egypt, we wot not as become of him. You see, they knew who Moses was. They knew exactly who Moses was. They said, Moses, who brought us up out of the land of Egypt. It's not like they didn't know that Moses was the one responsible for leading them. It's not like they didn't know Moses was the one that God was using in their lives. It's not like they didn't know that Moses was a standard setter inside their lives. It's just that they didn't want to be around Moses anymore. They said, we don't know what's going on around him. So in our lives, when we start saying, you know, Pastor, I don't know about those things that you're preaching in my life, but when we say, Pastor, I know about those things that are good for you, but they're not good for me, then we're pushing away the man of God from our lives. We say we start pushing away from him. The Bible says that the wicked fleeth when no man pursueth. You know, when I was with a friend of mine, and I went to check into a hotel, and I think it was sometime last year, and we were on our way out of the hotel. We checked in. When we checked in, there was a man. It was late at night. When we checked out in the morning, it was a young lady, and she was not dressed appropriately. But we came down. We were both inside shirts and ties, and she could tell. We went to go hand her a gospel tract, and the very first thing she did was she started covering up, trying to rearrange her attire so that way she was appropriate. When we start rearranging ourselves because the man of God comes into our presence, the pastor comes into our presence, and we start fixing ourselves, you know, that tells us that we weren't living the way that we ought to when he wasn't around us. So the first thing I can tell the first way you start getting away from God is when you start getting away from the man of God. Number two, you can start telling that you're getting away from God when your money is redirected. When your money is redirected. You know, there was an anthropologist, and he started looking at religions of the world. And one of the things that he found out about every religion is that everybody pays money to the person they worship. Everybody pays money to the person that they worship. You say, well, whatever gets the bulk of your money as the person that you worship most. It's a fact. It's a fact. People who smoke, their god is cigarettes. People who gamble, their god is the bingo or the lottery. They pay their money into that purse. There's people whose god is sports, and they pay all their money, and they have all this memorabilia, and they have things all over the place. And I have friends, they have season tickets, but the last time that they put a penny inside the church offering plate, they can't tell you. Why? Because they redirected their money. Verse number two, these people are down at the bottom, and God's man is up top, and God's dealing with him and telling him how people are supposed to live. But then you look at verse number two, and it says, and Aaron said unto them, break off the golden earrings, which are in the ears of your wives and of your sons and of your daughters, and bring them unto me. You'll say later on that the people were to use the gold and the silver and all the precious stones. They were supposed to use those things. God told Moses, the people who were of a willing heart, let them bring those things in. But these people at this point in time, they took what was precious to them and they started making another god for themselves. How much greater the temple would have been if these people would have reserved what was for God later on and not held it at this point in time. They said, we're going to sacrifice what we have now, and we're away from God, and we're going to take our money and we're going to spend it the way that we want to. And that's the way that you can see it in America today. People spend their money on a bunch of junk. They spend their money on anything that pleases them. They have a big house and a big car. They have, my pastor raises German Shepherds back home. They do it, and one, it helps the kids learn character. Two, they're just, they think they're fun to be around. I don't really think they're fun to be around. But lastly, it makes them a good amount of money. But you want to know, they're looking on Craigslist, and they're looking for, they have a AKC German Shepherd stud, and they're looking, they're looking for a female German Shepherd that they would help them, and they could breed, and they could make more money doing that and help support his family. There's people on there looking $10,000 for a dog. That's craziness to me. I'm thinking, man, you know what I could do? I could buy a car for $10,000, and I can't even ride that dog. Are you kidding me? There's no reason. I can't even ride the dog, and it's costing $10,000. Third one, that's craziness. But you want to know what? People have so redirected their money and so redirected their values that they spend it on junk. They spend it on houses and cars. And I'm not against houses and cars. I like living indoors, okay? I'm what you call indoorsy. But I'm not going to spend extravagant amounts of money on something crazy. And people, you could tell that people in a church house, that when they start taking their money out of the offering plate, when they stop giving to missions, when you don't give to the, when you don't tithe, when you don't give an offering, when you don't give to the bus ministry, and when you don't invest in other people, then you could tell people are starting to get away from God and they're far from God when they're taking their money and they're paying it into everything else. People are away from God when they get away from the man of God. People are away from God when their money is redirected. People are away from God, thirdly, when they stop listening to preaching. When they stop listening to preaching. Verse number 8, let's start looking at verse number 7. The Bible says, "And the Lord said unto Moses, Go get thee down, for thy people, which thou broughtest up out of the land of Egypt, have corrupted themselves." And then he defines how they corrupted themselves. "They have turned aside quickly out of the way which I commanded them. They have made them a molten calf, and have worshipped it, and have sacrificed thereunto, and said, Praise be thy gods, O Israel, which we have brought thee up out of the land of Egypt." You can look at that, and that self outlines itself. It says, "They have turned aside quickly out of the way which I have commanded them." How do they know which way God commanded them? Because a preacher came up to them and said, "This is the way that God wants you to go." The preacher comes up to me and said, "This is the word of God, and this is the way we're going to live. This is the way our church is going to be run." And you're going to be like, "Nope, I'm not doing that. We ain't going that way." Pastor comes up and says, "You need to come to church 3 times a week. And you say, "I don't need to go to church 3 times a week. Pastor comes and says, "We need to go soul winning." You're like, I have my Saturdays to myself. Pastor comes and says, "You need to dress right." And you're like, "I don't need to do all that stuff." You turn away quickly out of the way. And the Bible tells us that you get far from God. The man of God is learning how to lead God's people. And God's people are down at the bottom of it. And they say, "We don't want to hear what you say." It says, "Which I have commanded them." And then it leads unto other things. You see, people don't just fall into sin. They drag themselves into sin. They push themselves away from the good. They stop hanging around the man of God. And is the man of God God? No. But I think it's a godly influence, and you ought to include him in your life. And then you see that their money is redirected. They stop paying money into things that matter and the things of God. And then they stop listening to preaching. They stop listening to preaching. You ought to listen to preaching. I think that you ought to find some people that your pastor approves of and listen to them. I'm reading a book. Pastor Haley gave me a book to read. It's called Fundamentals in My Lifetime. That's preaching in ink. I like reading those things. I like reading sermons. I like listening to sermons. One of my favorite sermons in the whole world is I Plan on Staying Fundamentalist by Alan Domley. I love that sermon. I like listening to Pastor Haley preach. I used to listen to him preach on the Wednesday night soul winning bus. And we used to have a soul winning bus down there. I need to get up. And now it's time for story time with Zach. And Pastor Haley would get up there. And back when he was just Richard. And he'd get up there and he'd jump up on the middle of the soul winning bus and talk about the Bible and talk about things like that. And people would say, "You got to imagine this. This is a Baptist or Hellfire and Damnation soul winning bus. And there's this guy preaching about the King James Bible. We got liberals on the bus." And we probably did, but they were too bansy to speak up about anything. So he's like, "Get your hands off my Jesus." And he's sitting there ripping and snorting. And I'm like, "Yeah, go get him." I couldn't see him because he's not tall enough to sit above the seat. So he had to get on a seat or something. He starts yelling at us. I couldn't see him to save my life. But I could hear him. I could hear his preaching. And I could just spin enough. I could hear the spit in the seat in front of him. Praise God. But you ought to listen to preaching. You ought to listen to a lot of preaching. When the preacher comes in to teach Sunday school, you ought to have your Bible out and take notes. and of mental and take mental notes and remember those things and remember statements. I when you come into Sunday morning preaching, you ought to be ready. And I find a lot of times that the people who get things from God preaching are the people who want to get something out of preaching. Amen. You want to know what? If you don't want to get something, you're not going to get something. You should come to church expecting, God, show me something that I could fix in my life, that I could be a better Christian for you. That should be your mindset. People come to church and you're like, well, that's not just for me. Well, are you awake? I mean, really, it's not that hard. Are your eyes open? Are your ears open? Do you have a pen? Do you have a pencil? Do you have something? The people who don't want to get anything out of preaching are the people who don't get anything out of preaching. I have a friend. They have a saying at their house: if you leave hungry, it's because you're stupid. that's the truth. If you come to church, I know Pastor Haley. If you come to this church and you leave spiritually hungry, it's because you're stupid. You didn't eat enough. You just didn't want to eat. I like eating. I can't tell, but praise the Lord, I like to eat. But how can you tell you're far from God? You're away from the man of God. Your money is being redirected. You're far from God when you stop listening to preaching. Number four, you're away from the man of God when you change your music, when your music changes. You know, there's a lot of people, they start out good, and you could tell them, you could tell that turning point in their life. I mean, you can't change, as a church member, you're not be able to tell all the rest of these things. I can't tell if somebody's pulling themselves away from the man of God. I can't tell if somebody's not tithing. I, as a church member, can't tell if somebody's not listening to preaching. But I could tell when they get their music changed, boom, there's immediate change in the rest of their life. I promise you there is. Amen. There, you take teenagers who are rebels, I promise you they're not listening to godly music. Right. You take adults who are rebels, I promise you they're not listening to godly music. You take any person and you put them under bad music, and I promise you they'll have bad results. You put trash in, you'll get trash out. Right. We look down and we look down at verse number 16 of chapter 32. Verse number 16, the Bible says, I apologize, verse number 17. The Bible says that when Joshua heard the noise of the people as they shouted, he said unto Moses, there's a noise of war in the camp. See, these people, they were coming down, and Moses had met up with Joshua, general. Joshua's like, dude, he didn't say dude. He probably didn't say dude to Moses. Sorry about that. He was like, Pastor Moses, I don't know what's going on down there, but it's not good. And he's like, what do you mean? It's like war. So they get a little bit closer. And we pick up in verse number 18, and it says, and as he said, it is not the voice of them that shout for mastery, neither is the voice of them that cry for being overcome, but the noise of them that sing do I hear. That's a perfect that's a perfect description of music today, especially when it comes to contemporary Christian music, when it comes to just about any of that junk, when it comes to Southern Gospel, when it comes to those different kinds of things. And if you ever want to get me irritated, talk about Southern Gospel, because I promise you, you could probably insult a family member and get away unscathed, but you bring that up, and, oh man. He said, it's the noise of them that sing, do I hear? They're coming down, and they get down to the bottom, and these people who are far from God, and their music, he's like, it sounds like war. And Moses is like, no, they're singing. And I promise you, they weren't singing the songs of Zion. They weren't singing the songs we sang tonight out of the hymnal. They were singing war songs. They were singing the songs of Egypt. Egypt was a warrior-like nation. They conquered people, and they just made people slaves, and they went out, and they did what they wanted, and they would enslave people and bring them back and make them do what they wanted to do. And the people of God were out in this wilderness, and Moses is up on his way back down, and he hears these people singing, and they're singing the songs that they were singing when they were enslaved. Amen. The songs that they sang back when they were conquered. They went back and they stopped singing the songs that had made them happier, the songs that God gave them. And the man of God is on his way down, and they're singing the songs that they learned in Egypt by the people who had conquered them. And they had cried for 400 years, God, deliver us from this. And now they're on the other side of that, and they went back to what they cried away from. They went back. How often do we, as Christians, we go to church and things start going well and we get things going on in our life, and then we automatically say, well, you know, I'm mature, I could listen to this again. You can't listen to that again. You can't go back to that junk. I promise you, you start listening to that, and it's going to lead down to a negative effect. Almost every time that I could tell in my life that there was a backsliding, praise the Lord for His grace, it was soon followed up by a period of, well, I was new. I was listening to music that I wasn't supposed to be listening to. I remember, I tell you just about every time like that. Hopefully there wasn't a whole bunch of them, but there was plenty of times where I wasn't what I was, what I ought to be. I can tell you, those are times where I was tempted or I went and I listened to the wrong music. And I could tell it was wrong music because of music I wasn't bringing around my friends. It's the music that I didn't hear at church. It's the music that I put away when the preacher came around. It's the music that all my godly friends, I didn't want them to listen to or catch me listening to it. Why? Because it's not the songs that we need to. When we're far from God, our music changes. You can tell somebody is far from God when they change their music, and you tell you're far from God when your music changes. I'm telling you, I'm not very old, as you can tell, okay? That's not hard to see. But I've been going to church for a decent amount of time. I've worked with, I went to two different public, I went to two different public schools, high school, and to two different public schools, and then went to two different Christian schools. I was homeschooled for a short period of time. I've gone to church as a teenager for quite a period of time. I know young people, and then knowing the young people, I learned their parents. And the kids who came from a home where the parents played junk music, the kids turned out like junk. And then the kids who wanted to listen to that junk music, they turned out like junk. And the kids who rebelled against their godly parents, their music was junk. I promise you that. You get kids who are playing war games, and they have all that junk music on there. Those kids have a worse walk with God that you ever see in your life. Why? Because their music changes. They go back to things that they are delivered from. Then I want to point out to you, the last way I can tell that you're away from God is that people change their wardrobe. People change their wardrobe. Yeah. Yep. Verse number 25, they get down and Moses comes down, and first God's angry, and God says, Moses, I'm going to destroy them all. I'm done. Moses, I'm going to spare you. Everybody else is dying. Moses is like, don't kill him, God. All the people are going to think you're a bad God if you kill them all. He's like, okay. Moses, you deal with them. So Moses gets down there, and Moses sees them naked. He's like, I'm going to kill them all. It was well, you're doing a great job, Moses. But Moses gets down in verse number 25, and the Bible says, and when Moses saw that the people were naked, for Aaron had made them naked under their shame among their enemies, then Moses stood in the gate of the camp and said, who is on the Lord's side? Let him come unto me. And all the sons of Levi gathered themselves together unto him.
Amen.
I want to point out to you, verse number 25, the Bible says, and when Moses saw that the people were naked, bet you they weren't naked when Moses went up to the mountain. Bet you they weren't. Why? Because a man of God was down there preaching, all you guys get your clothes on. Everybody get your clothes on. We're not like Egypt. Get your clothes on. And then he went up to the mountain. He came back down. And he saw they were naked. I don't think that God would have taken note of that if they were naked beforehand. But Moses came down and these people were naked. You can tell that America has gotten far away from God because of how much their clothes come off. And it's everywhere. We are talking. I was greatly encouraged about Spangles, and Spangles, our food's great. I love Spangles. I mean, their fries were delicious. I had salt and vinegar fries, and then afterwards I warmed up my chicken because I was too much of a I don't know what the word would be, but I couldn't eat all of that at the same time. You know, I was full, and so I ate my chicken afterwards. But I was told how great Spangles is, and I walk into Spangles, and there's a statue. As soon as you first walk in, a woman with her dress up. I'm like, how in the world have we come this far? And then you go to the supermarket. You go to the supermarket, and you're ready to check out. And if your supermarket's or anything like mine, and so far I've been to Dillon's, and that one's not too much different. And you go to Kroger, and that one's not too much different. You walk in, and right when you go to check out, they got candy, and then they got the beef jerky, and then they got 15 different magazines with half-naked women on them. And that's how far America's gotten away. I have a picture back home that was given to me of Myrtle Beach. I think it was in the 30s, late 30s. Myrtle Beach, late 30s, bunch of lost, people were as lost as a ball in high grass. Okay? They have no idea what Christianity is. They're not saved. They're not born again. They don't go to a Baptist church. They're as lost as the day is long. And they got skirts and dresses. The women do down. Well, praise God, the men don't. They down have them down to their ankle, and they're at the beach. They're at the beach, and they have dresses down to, and their tops are covered. I mean, everything's covered. And then the guys are out there inside polo shirts, and they have their shirts tucked in, and they have their breeches down to their feet, and they're at the beach. Today we walk down the street. There's not even a beach anymore, and people walk down the street naked. Why? Because you tell people to get away from God when they start taking their clothes off. I go a step further than that, and you can tell people to get away from God when they change their appearance. You can tell people, you can tell who somebody identifies by the way they look. You know, you can tell, it's easy. I have friends that graduate college, and immediately upon graduating college, boom, they change the way they look. Why? Because they were never, because what kept them successful was no longer good enough to keep them successful. And so they change their appearance. They start getting away from God. They start doing all that kind of stuff. They start reading books they ought not read. They start hanging around people they ought not read. Why? Because they get away from God, and it changes their appearance. I'd like to teach you something that I have learned. Somebody in this room already knows this. That's because they listened to one of my preaching CDs. But naked in the Bible does not necessarily mean uncovered. Okay? It does not necessarily mean uncovered. Let me illustrate. I don't have... He said there's bottles of water up here. And there are bottles. Excuse me, I'm down here getting a bottle of water. Miss Glendon in the back said he could do just about anything except run because we'll chase you down. So I'm taking that seriously. I'm not running. And if I'm running, you should probably call the police because I'm running from something. I'm lazy. But I have a bottle of water. This bottle of water, in case you did not know this, is covered. Did you know that? I pour it out. There's nothing coming out of the inside of there. But you know, I could tell exactly what's on the inside of the bottle of water. Do you know why? Because the covering tells me what's underneath. Did you know that you don't have, and so that water right there, according to the Bible, is naked because I could see what's underneath. Did you know if our appearance tells people more than it ought to, that we're naked? Did you know that? If our apparel, and it goes for guys just as much as girls, I have more friends that are guys that now are trying to show off their chest. I'm like, dude, you got like 3 tires on there. You shouldn't be showing that off. Put it away. But you want to know what? They take shirts and they try to address themselves, and it reveals much more than it ought to. According to the scripture, they're naked because I can see what they have on. And when you start moving away from God, you start taking your clothes off, you start dressing the way you ought not to, you start dressing the way the world does, because that's the way the Egyptians were. The Egyptians were a very fleshly civilization. They were a very, whatever goes on as the way that it is, and that's the way that they want it to be. And so when the people started moving away from God, they started hanging out, and they started spending time, and started becoming more like the Egyptians. And the last way that became like Egyptians, they started dressing like them. They just took off their clothes. And I want you to point out 2 more things, if I may. First one is verse number 25, the last part. For Aaron had made them naked unto their shame among their enemies. Did you know being naked is a sign of being ashamed? If you take a little child that's not that hard, they start getting to 3 years old, and they know to cover up. You don't even have to teach them. It's all of a sudden, one day, I have nieces and nephews, and you know, one day you open the door to try helping them get their clothes on. And what do? And you have to teach them that. You open the door and wham! They're like, what are you doing in here? You're like, I did that to my dad one time. My dad was like, I own you. And I own the house. I own the room you're in. You know, you don't have a house. I have your house. But you want to know what? They cover themselves up. See, I told you I was going to have myself laughing. I'm having a good time. But I know what? They cover themselves up. You don't have to teach that. That's a shame for somebody to be uncovered. People need to get back to that. People aren't ashamed anymore about being naked. Why? Because they're far from God. You could tell it. America today, first they started moving away from the man of God. They stopped coming to the house of God. They start putting themselves around the man of God. They stopped coming to him for counsel. And then they redirect their money. So many other things that people invest their money in today other than the house of God. It's ridiculous. People stop listening to preaching. Preaching is a moral conscience of America. Amen. It's a moral conscience of any nation. You can tell a nation when they stop listening to preaching, they're going down. Then people change their music. People change their wardrobe. You say, what's there left to do? And sermon should never be ended with just damnation. Should never be left with condemnation. So I think that there's one last thing is that there's hope at the end of it all. Everybody should be able to say, you know what? I've done one or maybe all of these things. But there's still a way to be restored to all that. There's still a way for America to be restored at the end of all these things. There's still a way for any home, any church, any person, any institution to come back and be restored to God at the end of this all. Verse number 26, you'll read that Moses stood in the gate of the camp and said, "Who is on the Lord's side? Let him come unto me." And all the sons of Levi gathered themselves together unto him. I want to point out to you, the Bible says it never talks about Levi being the sons of Levi being separated from anybody else. If you read the scripture, the sons of Levi, it's not like, you know, everybody else in Egypt was over here being naked and the sons of Levi weren't keeping themselves pure. That's not the way it was. If you just read the scripture for what it says, Moses stood up and here's everybody, and Moses just stands up and says, "Who's on the Lord's side?" And the sons of Levi separated themselves. But if, according to the context, they're just as bad as everybody else. If you want to today, you say, "Well, you know, I've done one of these things." It's as easy as separating yourself from those things and saying, "I'm on the Lord's side. I'm not going to do this anymore." That's it. I'm just not going to do it anymore. And you will have to separate yourself. For these people had to separate themselves from the other tribes of Israel. They had to separate themselves from a lot of things. But they just said, "We're on the Lord's side." I'll close with this. There's a man that I go to school, obviously, in Texas. And we have an assistant pastor there. And his name's Dexter Landers, right? Pastor Dexter Landers. Brother Landers is an interesting individual. Anybody who knows Brother Landers knows that he's an interesting individual. He's one of my favorite people in the whole world. Some people mock him because they say that he's simple. I love him because I think that he loves the Lord. And he's a great preacher, and you're always happy when you get done hearing him preach. And I work at McDonald's. Well, I worked at McDonald's. I know that I work at McDonald's when I go back. But when I did work there, there was twice during the summer that, I mean, you got to imagine, it's McDonald's. It's Longview, Texas. It's hotter than, you know, it's just hot outside. And, you know, and it's right on blacktop, and there's no shade, and there's no clouds, and it's just hot. And so people come into McDonald's wearing whatever, I don't know, I think they forgot to dress themselves that day, so they just come into McDonald's, and that's what they have on. And then you have in the back of McDonald's, I'm sitting there running the store, and you have employees everywhere, some of them are on their phones, and some of them whatever have you. And Brother Landers walks in the door, walks in the first door, and you can see just the grin on his face, because he knows what's coming, and I know what's coming, it's just going to be a good time. And he gets a grin on his face, and he's like, I'm telling you, it's like blitz mode. I'm just going to kill something. So he like opens the first door, opens the second door to McDonald's, takes one step in, and he's a short guy. He's kind of chubby. And he just stands up, puts his hands up in the air like this, yells real loud, "Who's on the Lord's side?" In the middle of McDonald's. I'm serious. And everybody stops and be like, "Is this the rapture?" Because, oh dear God, if it is. And they all get scared. I say that to say this. It's to be right with God, it's always a moment thing. You say from this point forward, you know, if all the people at McDonald's at that point in time were said, you know, "I'm on the Lord's side," and they were to stop doing what they were doing, they would have been all right. But if you were to say, "Lord, right now I'm sorry for what I've done. I'm on your side and I won't do it anymore," then there's restoration. And then after that point in time, you see that the sons of Levi were separated to God, and God used the sons of Levi in a great and mighty way, and they even ministered in the tabernacle, and God used them for a special purpose unto himself. And we can learn that if we separate ourselves and we say, "God, I'm on your side. I'm not going to do that anymore. I may not be perfect, but I'm going to live up to your standards as best I can," that God used you in a special way with dealing with people and doing everything like that. Let's be the kind of Christian where we're not far from God. Let's be the kind of Christian where we just say, "I'm the Lord's side. I'm going to do what God says to do." Let's pray.